Something in this story told by Jesus goes down a bit too easily. It's not the story itself. The master gives quite different sums of money to the three slaves with no explanation given. We don't like such random inequalities, especially if we end up on the short end. The one who buries the money gets trashed with weeping and gnashing and all of the rest. A not too pleasant conclusion, particularly on a stewardship sermon Sunday. It's important, though, to grapple with these texts that rub us the wrong way, lest we come to think the God of the Bible is, as Joan Osborne sang, just one of us. One of the things that often makes this passage more palatable is the word talent. Routinely, this parable is taken as an encouragement to discover what gifts and talents we all have and to use them for God. In this light, the parable points out that everyone has at least one talent. Oh, sure, some may have more, but we've all got one. And regardless of how many talents we each have, the parable obviously says that God wants us to use them wisely. Yeah, it's cool talking about the stewardship of our time and talents and about the non-monetary things given by God that must use to God's glory and not allow to selfishly waste away. You've heard that sermon before. I've probably preached it before. But, as Peter Parker's uncle reminded him in Spider-Man, with great gifts comes great responsibility. The sermon about the noblesse oblige required of the gifted is a sermon without a bite. But this is Jesus we're talking about. He didn't need to get crucified to tell people to use their talents, carpe diem, and all that kind of stuff. You don't have to look forward to his coming again to be told to spread your wings and fly, or other such saccharine. We should expect something more interesting here. To begin with, the talent Jesus is talking about has nothing to do with abilities and everything to do with money. A talent was a huge, unbelievable, unimaginable sum of money. Tom Long says it was about 15 years' wages for a typical worker. Now, according to statisticalatlas.com, the median income in Stanford is $76,000. So, a talent would work out to a little more than $1.1 million. And five talents, over $5.5 million. Now, that's a whole different ball game than, well, I'm great with kids, or I can play the piano, or I wield a mean rake for God, let me at those leaves. Imagine for a minute if somebody gave you a suitcase full of gold bullion and told you to invest it. If you could lift it, you'd probably stare at it and say to yourself, now, how exactly does one invest gold? Well, those ancient world slaves would have been even more bewildered by the king's ransoms they were given here. And so the one who goes off and buries the money did a really perfectly reasonable thing. Burying it was about the safest thing you could do with even small amounts of money back then, let alone an unthinkable fortune. Michael Budd is a political scientist at DePaul University in Chicago, and he's also a member of the Ecclesia Project, which is an organization committed to promoting radical discipleship in local congregations. Budd has a bone to pick with this story. He worries that if we leave this passage alone, it sounds too much like orientation day on Wall Street. Invest, and you will be rewarded. Save without interest, and you will be trashed. In an essay he wrote for a book, I love this title, God is not religious, nice, one of us, an American, a capitalist. Great title. Bud recalls other passages where Jesus hardly sounds like a friend to capitalists. Remember, sell all that you have and follow me. Or his praising the widow who gave her very last mite. Or Jesus shrugged and paying taxes while explaining, render to Caesar what is Caesar's. Those don't show up in Econ 101. Given what else we know about Jesus, a text that seems to trumpet the rich get richer, the poor get shafted, hardly seems right, even if it's playing so well within the halls of Congress right now. So Bud challenges us to imagine for a moment that the master in this story is not God, but the devil. And that the servant who defies the master is not a lazy, wicked slave, but Jesus himself. Now look at it from this way. This parable takes a much more dramatic turn. First off, all of a sudden, it sounds more like a parable from first century Palestine rather than 21st century Manhattan. And if, in fact, the master is not God, then it also has deep roots in the Hebrew scriptures with its assumption that wealth usually represents the subsistence of the poor unjustly exploited by the rich. And the most likely source of 100% return on wealth is going to be loans with predatory lending terms. How else could one double one's money in a pre-modern agrarian setting? We also then get a Jesus who refuses to heap further misery on the poor by participating in this kind of unjust system. He is a genuine suffering servant who is cast out into dark weeping and gnashing where most of the poor in that day and still today where they usually wind up. Wow. That puts a different spin on it, does it not? Now, Bud comebacks to concede that though the other parables surrounding it make it pretty clear that the master is most likely Jesus. Other biblical references to judgment and including the gnashing of teeth make clear that they're the destiny of wicked people, not Jesus. But we can still learn and hang on to thoughts being provoked by Bud's challenge to our just easy standard thinking about this parable. It might help to concentrate on the staggering sum of money, too much for these slaves to count or contemplate. It's being entrusted to these servants. And that unfathomable amount, that enormity, is exactly what our God gives us in God's own self, in Jesus, in the fellowship of the church. And good readers of the Bible know that when you come into money, the faith-filled thing is to give it away. It multiplies itself. Now, this is not standard investment strategy, because if it was, all financial planners would champion tithing as a way to turn a profit. I won't ask you those out there to raise your hand if you do. A number of years ago, I went to see a financial planner recommended by a friend, because I was way behind getting ready for any kind of retirement down the line. And we talked a while about what I was living on at the time and what I thought I would need in retirement. He estimated what Social Security and my pension would supply and then looked at the gap. He also asked me about my lifestyle and spending habits. It got interesting when we came to my delineation of what I considered fixed costs versus discretionary spending. He was puzzled that I had listed my charitable giving in the fixed cost rather than discretionary spending column. He asked me, "Is that like required of you because you're a minister?" I said, "No, it's not in any way, shape, or form related to my employment." So, okay, then, so we can actually move it and consider it discretionary. "No, we can't do that." He said, "Well, I don't quite understand." I said, "Well, it's like this. I happen to consider all that I am and all that I have as a gift from God. It's really not mine. And what God desires from me is that I return a portion of what I have been given in recognition and gratitude for God's blessings upon my life. And the biblical standard for that is 10%. "Oh," was all he could say. I didn't tell him that the biblical standard might be 10%, but my mother's standard was at least 15%, because the 10% was expected, and above that, then you were really saying thank you back to God. That's what has formed me. In his book, Divine Economy, Stephen Long argues that the fundamental difference between the Christian God and capitalism is that God presumes plentitude and abundance, and capitalism presumes and creates scarcity. God's economy is more about an open hand and an extra seat at the table rather than a clenched fist and a gated neighborhood. The servant who is punished describes the master as a harsh man, reaping where you don't sow and gathering where you do not scatter seed. But the master praises the other slaves. "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I'm going to give you a whole mass of them to take care of. Enter into the joy of your master." Now, I don't know about you, but if someone dropped a big old chunk of change on me and let me keep it, whatever else I might think about them, I'm not likely to call them stingy. Maybe that is a description of the church at its worst, especially in our age. Most mainline churches have struggled for decades with the loss of millions of members. Are we like that man sitting over the talent buried in the ground, keeping it safe, not risking, not gaining? Jesus once told his disciples to give to anyone who asks you. He was calling those who followed him to practice an economics of abundance, calling us to imitate the profligate generosity of our God, who gave to us without counting any cost as too dear for you and your salvation. We who are in Christ have an enormous, uncountable, unimaginable treasure, Jesus Christ. The only catch with this treasure is that the only way to keep it is to give it away. And when we do, then it comes back double in the form of others who will love Jesus with us. So give. Not because you have to, or because the church budget is going to suffer without it, or that the membership will decline if you don't. Give like you give to your children, because you love them and want to see them happy and fulfilled. Tell others about Jesus the way that you tell them about your favorite movie or your sports star, without any kind of reserve or hesitancy, like you can't help yourself. Give like you've been given to. When God sent his son even to death for us, remember that God's gifts are always intended to be shared, always meant to be passed on from God for giving. Amen.